Hello everyone, and welcome to our webinar on a practical guide to RNA sequencing for life science research. This is Dahlia Tay, Marketing Manager for Novogene's AIT Genomics, your moderators for today's webinar. A quick introduction about Novogene. We have an international presence across the continents in the UK, US, and Asia. In Asia, not only we have a good network of distribution partners in some markets, we are also strategically located in ANIA. This put us in a prominent position for us to cater our support and solutions to our customers in this region, so we can offer faster turnaround time, and more importantly, the dedicated support whenever you need. The founder and CEO of Novogene, Dr. Lee, is a well-known bioinformatics researcher. Hence, our expertise in bioinformatics is clearly shown in our DNA. Our sequence processing capacity is known to be the largest and capable to manage huge data. Just at an average per month, we sequence over 60,000 samples. Our partnership have numerous institutions and companies have proven us to be a competent NGS partner. Here, I'd like you to meet our latest development in next generation sequencing delivery platform system, Falcon, that was launched early this year. This fully automated delivery platform is highly reliable and stable with a base call accuracy up to 99.9%. It can offer multiple library choices and comprehensive data analysis pipelines. It's the first of its kind NGS platform that makes it possible for us to process up to 3,000 samples in 24 hours, reducing the production cycle by 60% so we can deliver faster time to result to you with unsurpassed data quality with a guaranteed Q30 greater than 80% that exceeds Illumina's official benchmark. Enough said, here I welcome Xiaohui Man, our speaker for today. Xiaohui received a PhD in cell biology for cancer genetics from the China Medical University. She has over 12 years of professional experience where she served as a postdoctoral researcher at the Florida State University and research fellow at the National University of Singapore. Her works focus mainly on centrosome biology and cancer biology. She is the author of 9 publications. Previously heading the bioinformatics team, she is the scientific manager of Novogene AIT Genomics AMIA region. Hello Xiaohui, how are you?
Oh, very good.
You do have an impressive background. I don't come from that background like you. Is it true that when it comes to research study, the experimental design that you select for your RNA sequencing is critical for analysis results?
Yes, very critical. Depending on your biological question, you should choose the appropriate lab experimental design to answer your question and support your research hypothesis.
Yes, and in this session, we will have Xiaohui to address this. To all attendees, this is a live webinar. You can post your questions on the chat box at any time during the sessions, and we will catch up with them towards the end, including those who have posted their questions during their registration. At the end of the webinar, please take some time to answer to a short survey. Let us get started and over to you, Xiaohui.
Thanks, everybody. So welcome to our webinar. Oh, sorry for the delay. So for today's webinar, I will introduce different RNA sequencing technologies and the platforms. So for the last decade, RNA-seq has become a standard method for analyzing gene expression, identify full-length transcript or full-length isoform, and also allelic specific gene expression. And RNA-seq also has provided answer to a lot of research problems that cannot be answered by the DNA sequencing. So today I will talk about Novogene's product and service, different RNA sequencing technology platforms, single cell sequencing, and lastly, I'll finish with case study about RNA sequencing for different applications, like differential gene expression, variant calling, gene fusion detection, gene expression, and also discovery of novel link RNAs. So cartoon shown here is to illustrate the three different RNA sequencing methods that using three different platforms. so-called cell-read CDN sequencing using Illumina platform, the full-on CDN sequencing on either PacBio or Oxford Nanopore platform, and the direct RNA sequencing using the Oxford Nanopore. So all the methods have their own specific protocol for library preparation, like shown here. And both long and short-read sequence CDN sequencing, they have many steps shared during their protocol for library preparation. And all methods have a step called adapter ligation, and all methods, of course, are affected by sample quality and also the computational issues up and downstream of library preparation. So for the short-read CDN sequencing on Illumina platform, after library is prepped, the library molecule will cluster on the flow cell for sequencing using SBS chemistry. So during the sequencing, in each round of sequencing, the green DNA strand will be imaged and the fluorescence will be detected and base calling will be done accordingly. And reads up to 500 base pair can be generated. So for the full-on CDN sequencing using the PacBio platform, the library molecule will be loaded into the sequencing chips. So the sequencing chips has millions of the nanowell, also called GMW. At the bottom of nanowell is the polymerase. So the molecule, the library molecule will bind to this polymerase, and at each of the fluorescently labeled nucleotide is incorporated, the fluorescence will be recorded and the base will be called. So right now, reads up to 50 kb can be generated for this CDN sequencing on the PacBio platform. Then for direct RNA sequencing on the Oxford Nanopore, this library prep is quite straightforward, just adapter ligation step. Then on this adapter, there's a motor protein. Then the motor protein will control the translocation of the mRNA molecule from 3' to 5' through the nanopore. And this translocation will cause a change in the electronic current. And this change will be processed bioinformatically for base calling. So right now, according to their recent update, reads up to 10 kb can be generated for this dark RNA sequencing. So different methods and different platforms have different applications. So for short-read CDN sequencing on Illumina platform, this is still the predominant platform for the RNA sequencing, and nearly almost all the RNA sequencing methods are developed for this short-read sequencing, either for library prep or for bioinformatic tools. And it's mainly used for DGE, whole transcriptome analysis, small RNA, single cell, spatial transcriptomics, RNA protein interaction, structural RNA analysis. And for long-read CDN sequencing on PacBio or ONT, it's very suitable for the isoform discovery, de novo transcriptome, fusion gene detection, and also analysis of complex transcriptome. And the long-read direct RNA sequencing on ONT platform, it has the same application as the full-on CDN sequencing. And the special feature for this method is it's enabled to detect the epigenetic modification of ribonucleotide like methylation. So different methods have their own strengths and weaknesses. So for short-read, the strength is high throughput and a lot of library prep methods and a lot of computational algorithms for data analysis. And also the short-read sequencing is very robust. Their performance is very consistent. And also this platform, the sequencing cost is low and also the bears are well characterized. And the disadvantage is mainly associated with the computational issues like for de novo transcriptome and also the bias during library preparation like CTN synthesis and the PCR amplification, both of which will introduce the bias. And another disadvantage is mapping bias because it's so risk. Sometimes the algorithm has problem to map the reads confidently to the reference genome. And for long reads, the main advantage is for the identification of the isoform and the long transcript, and also for the epigenetic modification of ribonucleotide, like methylation I just mentioned. And also for this long reads, the computational algorithm is also very straightforward, for especially for de novo transcriptome. Like for the RNA-seq on PacBio, they totally do not need to do any assembling. And the disadvantage, of course, is the low throughput, high error rate, and degraded RNA samples cannot be processed on this long-read platform. So I will briefly introduce single-cell sequencing. So single-cell sequencing is a fascinating technology and is very sensitive for gene expression study at the single-cell level. And right now, more and more scientists are using this technology for their research. So it's especially suitable for identification of novel cell types, like the stem cells, also for identification of rare cell population, like rare immune cells, some progenitor cells, and also for performing gene expression in primary cells and identify the cellular heterogeneity and the biomarkers and the different biological conditions. And also one advantage for this single cell sequencing is like, especially for the 10x genomics, they have a full set of analysis pipelines available, and it's very easy to use, and also very easily you can install the whole analysis suite. So here, I will spend a little bit of more time on spatial transcriptomics. And again, spatial transcriptomics is a fascinating technology. And this technology actually combines the benefits of traditional histology techniques like immunohistochemistry, immunofluorescence, and HG staining, which the high throughput of NGS. So let's just review the basic concept behind this technology. So the idea actually is put a tissue section on this glass slide. And this glass slide has many of thousands of spots. And each spot has millions of spatially barcoded DNA probe, like shown here. And during this library preparation, the MI molecule will be released and will be captured by this probe. So shown here is an individual probe that at the cell prime, the probe is attached to the glass slide. And the probe consists of like cleavage site, amplification, the sequencing mode handle, spatial barcode UMI, and MI capture region. So after library preparation is finished, the sequencing step on any desired platform will decode the barcode sequence and also the MI sequence. So after data analysis, the transcriptome data can be mapped back to the histological data, like shown here. So this technology allows scientists to examine the histology protein expression and MI from the same tissue sections. It also allows you to discover the new tissue markers. Like the picture shown here, this is for spatial transcriptomics to capture the tree gene expression, this tree gene shown here. And you can see here the expression pattern captured by this spatial transcriptomics perfectly match the expression pattern by using the immunohistochemistry technologies. And shown here is application of spatial transcriptomics for gene expression study in a breast cancer tissue section. And this label 1-6 on this tissue section means the early stage of breast cancer, ductal carcinoma in situ, and this iron wave represents the advanced stage of breast cancer, invasive carcinoma. And on the heat map, you can see here, like different subset of cells express totally different genes. So yeah, the spatial transcriptomics allows you to check the gene expression on the tissue section. It's very cool. Yeah, like for this breast cancer study, maybe you can correlate the expression heterogeneity, which the cancer progression, patient survival, prognosis, or maybe any response to drug therapy, etc. So by taking advantage of different long-read, short-read sequencing technology and bioinformatic tools, Novogene offer a variety of paradigm service to study different aspects of transcriptomics in different species. For example, for messenger RNA, different product and packages are provided. So using RNA-seq, you can quantify the transcript, study the differential gene expression, or identify the new isoform or new transcript, or investigate the alternative gene splicing and the gene fusion. So for all the non-coding RNA, like link RNA and small RNA, we provide the product and package for identification of this non-coding RNA, functional annotation, DG analysis, and the pathway enrichment analysis. And for each non-coding RNA product, they also have their own features, like link RNA. We also provide the integrity analysis between link RNA and mRNA. For small RNA like microRNA, we also have analysis for identification of microRNA target genes. And if you want to study the gene fusion or alternative splicing, or you are interested in characterize a novel transcriptome, we also have RNA-seq product on PacBio platform. And also for single cell sequencing, we have the full set of the single cell sequencing service, like you can investigate gene expression or study the epigenetic network using the single cell ATAC, or capture gene expression on a tissue section using spatial transcriptomics. So I have talked a lot about the new technology. Let's now focus on what a typical RNA project looks like. So RNA sequencing, like all the other experiments, starts from a biological questions. So you have a biological questions, then how to answer this question? So in terms of RNA sequencing, there are a lot of analysis you can do to answer your questions. Like you want to focus on gene expression, or you want to do the alternative splicing, gene fusion dissection, or you want to confirm the variants you detect using the whole genome sequencing. So once you decide your questions and also the analysis you want to do, then you can perform the experimental design. Then after experimental design, the real RNA sequencing always starts from the wet lab, that you do the total RNA isolation, library preparation, sequencing on any desired platform, and then finally perform bioinformatic analysis, then compare your results to check if your results support your hypothesis. Yeah, so I think for the RNA sequencing experiments, the most frequently asked question about is replicates, like how many replicates I should have should I have technical replicates? Then how many replicates I should have for my biological replicates? So according to the recommendation from the INCO consortium, the technical replicates actually is not needed for RNA sequencing because the performance and the results is very consistent across different flow cells, different lengths, and even different indexes. Then for biological replicates, INCO recommend at least two, and the six is recommended by a lot of literature. And RNA sequencing is also considered as the most complicated among all the NGI sequencing applications. Different RNA species need different library prep methods, different data coverage, and even different data analysis algorithm. So in terms of like library preparation for messenger RNA sequencing, you can see here there are a lot of library prep methods, including the strain specific for the low input RNA samples, RNA-seq, and for prokaryotic strain specific library prep methods. So nowadays, I think most of scientists, they switch to use the strain-specific library preparation. Why? Because strain-specific library preparation allows you to identify where is your transcript comes from. It's from minus strain or it's from the plus strain. And also the strain-specific library preparation allows you to accurately identify the transcript. And for non-coding RNA, same, there are so many species like link RNA, small RNA include like circular RNA, sRNA, microRNA, and pVRNA. So all these species of RNA, they have their own requirement for library preparation methods. And the same for single cell sequencing. So for different application of single cell sequencing, like three-prime gene expression, five-prime gene expression, VDG, and the spatial transcriptomics, all these applications have their own specific library preparation methods, and also have their own specific sequencing parameter, data coverage, and analysis algorithm too. And the same for RNA-seq. So you are focusing on characterization of novel transcriptome or you want to study the isoform. So the data coverage, sequencing parameters, library prep methods will all different, yeah. So in the following 20 minutes, I will share some examples about how scientists are using our RNA sequencing service to solve their research problems. So the first example I want to share is about RNA-seq for gene expression studies. And according to a paper just published last year in Nature Review Genetics, so currently the differential gene expression or called DGE is still the main application for RNA sequencing. You can see here, till last year, there are more than 18,000 papers were published on RNA sequencing for DGE expression studies. And the year shown here is that the first paper that were published for this technology. So yeah, the first example I want to share is about RNA-seq. Contributes to reveal the mechanism of blastoma progression. So a little background first. A neuroblastoma actually is a very malignant tumor in children, and it accounts for more than 15% of cancer-related mortality. And this investigator is interested in the mechanism of neuroblastoma, and they are focusing on this gene family, ARM family. By using the public database for data mining, they identify a gene named RNA-seq, then RNA-seq is upregulated in public database in medical data. And they identify this upregulation using tumor tissue section and a neuroblastoma cell lines. And also interestingly, they found this upregulation of RNA-seq is correlated with poor survival of neuroblastoma patients. Yeah, at this point, if you find a gene that's upregulated in a tumor, and also this upregulation correlates with a poor survival of patients, you will be excited because this gene can be a potential oncogene. So to confirm their hypothesis, this gene may be an oncogene, they did a lot of in vitro assays to confirm that this gene is really tumorigenic in vitro using assay like a sulfica, metrogel, and the proliferation. So, next step, they did the interaction studies because this gene is a novel gene. And for any functional experiments, if you want to know this gene's function, I think the most important experiment is to find its interaction pattern. So they performed the mass spectrometry and found that this gene, RNA-seq, interacts with RBBP4. And also they confirmed this interaction using the co-immunoprecipitation. So in the following study, they carry out a lot of gut biochemistry and the molecular biology experiments to identify what's the function of this gene by investigate the functional consequence of the interaction between RNA-seq and RBBP4. And firstly, they found RNA-seq interact with RBBP4 protein to facilitate the PRC2 complex formation on the promoter of target gene. PRC2 complex is well known for the histone 3 K27 methylation to inhibit the gene expression. And also PRC2 complex will help to recruit the PRC1 to the promoter target gene. And the PRC1 will promote the formation of heterochromatin. And the heterochromatin formation again also inhibit the target gene's expression. And secondly, they found this RNA-seq increase the activity of EGH2. And EGH2 actually is the component of PRC2 complex. And EGH2 is responsible for transferring a methyl group to the histone H3 K27. So now, what's the role of RNA sequencing in this mechanism studies? Since the author have identified that RNA-seq promotes the formation of PRC2 complex and increase the activity of EGH2 to downregulate the target gene expression. So their question is, what's the target gene of RNA-seq? So the investigator performed the RNA sequencing analysis to identify the target gene from a cell line stably transfected with RNA-seq. And the DDE analysis showed in this volcano plot, more than 3,000 genes were downregulated and around 3,000 genes are upregulated. So by overlapping this DDE gene list, which are two public databases and also the CHIP database called PRC2 complex, they identify 14 genes were differentially expressed in RNA-seq overexpression cell lines, and especially for these three genes, SMAD9, CAT1, HSCST3, were downregulated. And this downregulation of these three genes actually correlates with the poor survival of neuroblastoma patients. So I think at this point, they successfully identified the function of RNA-seq and also the mechanism of RNA-seq correlates with the progression and the tumorigenesis of neuroblastoma. So let's review this project. The investigator for this paper used the mRNA sequencing to identify the differentially expressed gene from cell lines stably transfected with RNA-seq. And their molecular biology and the biochemistry assays prove that RNA-seq physically binds to RBBP4 to increase the PRC2 complex formation and the EGH2's micelle group transferring activity, and finally leading to the repress of target gene expression identified by mRNA sequencing. So the second example I want to share is about multi-omic studies, and RNA-seq is used for analyzing the gene expression, detecting fusion and the variant calling. So a little background first, the HCC tumor, hepatocellular carcinoma, is very heterogeneous. So shown here is a HCC staining section. You can see here, this tissue section are from the same patient, same tumor, but different lesion of the same tumor. You can see here, like every lesion has its own differentiation status, like for this lesion, is like poorly differentiated, and this one is well differentiated, and all this one without labeling is moderately differentiated. So they found this heterogeneity has never been documented so far. So they perform a comprehensive investigation to study the HCC heterogeneity by using a multi-omics studies. So they collect 42 samples from 8 patients, and on each sample they performed the whole exome, whole transcriptome, proteomics, and the metabolomic, CYTOF, and single cell sequencing to comprehensively study the heterogeneity of HCC tumor. And finally, they successfully identify 3 subtypes. So this study will provide more information for understanding the mechanism of HCC progression and also provide the information for development of novel therapy strategies. So they studied the heterogeneity of HCC at different omics level, like I just mentioned, whole genome, whole transcriptome, proteomics, metabolomics. Yeah. So here I just show the data for whole genome and the whole transcriptome. So at the whole genome level, they identify 11,000 non-synonymous SNV. At the RNA level, they identify 14,000 non-synonymous SNVs. Like I just mentioned, if you have a whole genome sequencing or whole exome sequencing, actually you can use RNA sequencing to check if your variants are actually expressed. Yeah, so for this study, they check this. And you can see here, for all the variants at the DNA level, around 6,000 are actually expressed. And they also found for somatic variants, about 20% are expressed at the RNA level. And also for proteomic variants, RNA variants were more likely to be confirmed compared with DNA variants. I think this is quite normal because of the the central dogma. And RNA sequencing also is used for the gene expression studies. And very interesting, they found for DG analysis, the HCC is very heterogeneous. You can see here, this is the Venn diagram for DG gene list. You can see this all lesions from the same tumor, same patients. Like all the lesions, they share very little portion of DG gene list. All have their own specific differentially expressed gene. And the same for downstream KGD pathway enrichment. All lesions have different pathway enriched. And the same for gene fusion studies, you can see, again, this is from same patients, same tumor, different lesions, but all different lesions, they have their own gene fusion profiling. So all the results indicate that HCC is very heterogeneous at R level and also at the DNA level. And the data I didn't show here, actually at the proteomics level and the metabolomic levels, HCC is also very, very heterogeneous. It's not possible you can classify the HCC into any like distinct subtype using single omics data. So this investigator, I think, is very smart. So they integrate the different omics data, including the whole exome, a whole or transcriptome, and also the metabolomic data. Then they develop an algorithm for the enrichment pathway identification. And very likely, by combining this multi-omics data, they identify two pathways, PS3K, AKT, and the synthesis and degradation of ketone bodies was selectively enriched for the HCC tumor. And also very interesting, they found these two pathways were strongly correlated with the abundance of tumor-infiltrating T cells. And they also found that actually for the HCC tumor, the immune status of HCC microenvironment is less heterogeneous. So based on all this information, they decide to do an immune profiling using the CYTOF. Since this, the two pathway identified were correlated with the immune status of HCC microenvironment, and also because of the immune status of microenvironment is less heterogeneous. And you can see here the CYTOF data successfully identified three distinct subtypes. You can see cluster one, cluster two, and then cluster three. So these three subtypes have different immune functions. The first one is have the normal immune function. The subtype two has a deficient immune function. And the subtype three has the suppressive immune functions. And for the functional gene expression and also the biomarker expression of these three different subtypes, they use RNA sequencing and also single cell expression to validate the biomarker or functional gene expression. So again, let's review this project. I think this is a very typical example that scientists use multi-omics data to solve complicated biological problem, so-called tumor heterogeneity. And I think this is a great paper. If you are planning to do any multi-omics data, I will recommend you to read this paper. This is a good reference. So review this project here. So investigators, in order to study the heterogeneity of HCC, so they integrate the whole exome, whole transcriptome, and the metabolomic data. Then they develop a multi-omics algorithm to identify the enrichment pathway. And very likely they found these two pathways, PS3K, AKT, and the ketone bodies were selectively enriched in the HCC tumor. And these two pathways were also correlated with the abundance of tumor-infiltrating T cells, suggesting the immune status may be a biomarker for the HCC tumor classification. So based on this information, they performed the CY tau for immune profiling and successfully identified three subtypes. And of course, they use mRNA sequencing and a single cell gene expression again to validate the expression of biomarker or functional genes. Yeah. Again, I think this is a great paper really for multi-omics data. So the last example I want to share about for novel transcript discovery and the linker discovery using the RNA-seq. So a little background first. So the uterine endometrium undergoes dramatic morphological and functional changes during embryo development. And this investigator is interested to understand the genetic mechanism that regulates the endometrium to increase the rate of successful implantation. They use whole transcriptome sequencing to determine how many and which linker or RNA are differentially expressed and what's the relationship between mRNA linker and also which pathways or biological process are contributing to this successful implantation process. So here is the strategy and the workflow. Yeah, this line here means the investigator isolate the RNA, then send the RNA sample to Novogene, and Novogene will perform sample to data analysis. Yeah. In the previous two case studies, I didn't mention yet. Yeah, so for this studies, the investigator collect the endometria at day 9, day 12, and day 15 of pregnant pig, and at 15, at day 15, they collect sample for the control pig, and they isolate the total RNA. Then for wet lab, the strain-specific RNA sequencing library was prepared because for this integral analysis between linker and mRNA. So data analysis starts from the transcriptome assembling, followed by filter for non-coding, non-protein coding transcript for identification of novel linkers, and these four algorithms were used for filter out the protein coding transcript. Then the data analysis results found that at day 12 of pregnancy, the mother embryo in communication mainly occur at this data of pregnancy, and around 2,800 linkers were identified. And the downstream analysis consists of two parts. One is functional annotation of linker, and the other part is the disease analysis. So functional analysis, we just show like geoterms like protein binding and extracellular matrix are the main function for these novel linkers. And for disease analysis, like here, different genes and the linker were identified that are differentially expressed in this pregnant endometria. And for downstream KDD pathway enrichment, they found these four pathways, PS3K, AKT, MAPK protein digestion and absorption, and the insulin signaling pathway were selectively enriched for this pregnant day 12. So I think it's quite normal. All these pathways are involved in the cell proliferation. So again, let's review this project. So for this project, the stranded RNA library were prepared and the sequence on the Illumina platform, and the investigator found more than 2,800 linkers, and around 300 linkage were found to be differentially expressed in pregnant endometrium. And the pathway enrichment, they identified PI3K, insulin, and MAPK pathway, suggesting that this pathway are contributing to the increased success rate of pre-implantation. Yeah. So shown here is a demo result from our mRNA sequencing reports. Because I think we talk about so much about case study. So this is the actual results we will provide for different mRNA sequencing products. So shown here is the bioinformatic analysis. So we have the FASTQ reference genome annotation and go to the bioinformatic pipeline. And the after analysis, we have the raw data report, alignment report, and also a lot of report I didn't show here. And we also provide a publication ready data, and the figures like shown here is the genomic feature of the mapping reads, and this is the coverage, and this is the PCA plot. You can see the how is the quality of your experimental. Then shown here is the heat map, what kind of block for DG analysis, and this is a proton-proton interaction network creation. Yeah. And lastly, summarize the webinar. I think the cell is still the predominant method for DG analysis, and the single cell sequencing, including the spatial transcriptomics, are going to become a standard practice in many laboratories. And also long-read sequencing will replace Illumina cell-read sequencing as a default method for many applications. And of course, for this scenario to occur, still this long read platform need to increase their throughput and improve their base calling accuracy.
Great. The content is indeed insightful. Okay, now I would like to share with you why we are well positioned to be your competent partner for NGS solutions. At Novogene, we value long-standing relationship with our customers. We take great pride in delivering solutions fit to meet your research goals, as our team of dedicated experts are there to lend their technical insights through the choice of sequencing applications and platforms up to data analysis management. And so would like to emphasize that we are reliable and provides faster turnaround time. We have a large assembly of NGS systems, including our very own Falcon system and the strategic locations of our laboratories and branch offices that can provide prompt service to our customers in the EMEA region. Secondly, we have a wide applications breadth offering multiple library choices and a comprehensive data analysis pipeline for your research needs. Thirdly, we deliver unsurpassed data quality. Our informatics expertise and sequence processing capacity are capable to manage and deliver superior data quality that exceeds Illumina's official benchmark and any other NGS providers. And lastly, we have extensive experience and records of sequencing projects that have been published in journals. Yeah, so, okay, so let's go to the Q&A session. Thank you for all your questions coming in from the chat box and from the registrations form. Due to time, we can only address a couple of them, but not to worry for those questions that we are unable to address here, we can still reach out to you with our response after the webinar. Okay, let me look through. Okay, here I spotted the questions from the registration form. Okay, Xiaohui, here's a question. Can Novogene do circular RNA sequencing? When do we need to do strand-specific library?
Yes, of course, we can. We have product package for circular RNA sequencing. And also, the strand-specific library is highly recommended. especially if you have a species that the transcriptome is very complicated and you have a lot of overlapping gene expression from both minus and plus strands. So this strand-specific library preparation will allow you to do a very accurate transcript quantification, also to identify where your transcript come from, either minus strand or plus strand. And also, most of scientists now, they switch to use strand-specific library preparation, yeah.
Okay, I hope that answered the questions. Okay, next one from the floor. When we do eukaryotic strand non-specific library compared to strand-specific library?
If your species is not, I mean the you don't see a lot of like overlapping gene expression from both minus and plus strand, then I think maybe in this case you still can use the general so-called non-strand-specific library preparation.
Okay, thank you, Xiaohui. There's this very unique questions that we are afraid we are unable to address your question in these sessions. The questions that came on from the registration is how to use different databases for comprehensive translatome analysis. Okay, this is due to very detailed analysis being complicated. For this, we will have our technical support to liaise with you separately. And the time is also nearly to be up. Thank you very much, Xiaohui, and to all attendees. Yeah, there's so much questions that we would love to answer all of them, but unfortunately, we do not have much time left. And to all your questions that you left at the chat box and also at the registration forms, we will have our representative to reach out to you after the webinar. We have come to the end. We hope you have enjoyed our sessions and find it useful. Please take some time to answer to a short survey for us to make improvements and cater more of such topics relevant for you. You can find the link at the chat box here. Okay, so for more information about our RNA sequencing, please visit en.novogene.com. Stay connected with us on LinkedIn and Twitter. And Xiaohui, do you have any more thing to add on?
No, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Okay, then everyone take care and stay safe.
Bye-bye.
Bye.